go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you that on this weekend, as we celebrate our country, as many of us celebrate with very little thought even to what is the cost that's been paid, just bring to our mind, bring to our memory that there are people who died right out of the beginning, right out of the gate, before we were even a nation. There were people who were willing to die for freedom. There were people who were willing to die that we could come here and worship in freedom. We realize, Lord, that we owe a debt we can never repay. And yet, I ask you to help us to repay by being the citizens that you would want us to be, by being exemplary in the lives that we live, that we might give glory to you, and that we might give honor to those who have fought for a nation such as this. Lord, we know we do not live in a perfect nation. In so many ways, our nation is tattered today. In so many ways, we are torn asunder. But we thank you for the confidence that we have in coming to this place. Thank you for the confidence that we have that there are men and women who are standing in their place, the place assigned to them, holding the line. There are people working behind the scenes to make sure that freedom is intact. And there are those who at the moment's notice would be willing to give their lives. Thank you for those who've gone before. Thank you for their diligence. Thank you that even in times when they weren't sure about the cause, they willingly gave of themselves on the battlefield. And we celebrate them. From the very beginning of our nation to today, we celebrate them. Thank you for them. And I pray that you will help us, that their sacrifice would not be lost to us. Thank you for those certain unalienable rights that we have today, life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness. And most of all, thank you that we can worship freely here in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Turn with me, please, in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 6. Thank you, Becky. You always do a great job, Adam. Thank you for a great job with just reminding us. I know Becky's dad was a patriot, and it is reflected in Becky as well, and we appreciate that. Today we're talking about confidence, and, you know, I think confidence is something we'd all really like to have, isn't it? If we have, and some of us have it more naturally than others. We just are confident. Some people just exude confidence, and some of us fake it pretty well, on the other hand, right? And we fake it pretty well, but the natural confidence is something that can get rocked pretty easily. Maybe you have a lot of confidence in the way you look. Somebody's told you you're pretty or you're handsome, and you say, but with time or accident or illness or age, that can change pretty incredibly and pretty quickly. Maybe you are confident in your accomplishments. You've done well. Maybe in school, maybe in your work or whatever, you've done really, really well in those things. But life can change that too. I was talking with a guy a few days ago who was really had a lot of confidence in his family, and his family heritage. His family just was an exemplary family, and he was so proud of the Christian heritage and so many things in his family. But just recently, a skeleton had come crawling out of the closet in his family. And it had really shaken his confidence in something that was a large part of his identity. Probably most of us can say, you know, there's something in my life I'm really confident in. But if you look at it and examine it, it's something that could very easily, the rug could be pulled out from under you very quickly. And that is especially true when we talk about things that are human things, confidence in human things. But Jesus spoke of confidence that is built on a solid foundation. He said, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew, and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. The rain came, the streams rose, and the winds blew, and beat against that house, and fell with a great crash. Confidence comes in the Word of God, what God has said, what God has spoken to us. Our confidence, when we put our confidence in Him, we have a strong foundation. We can have tremendous fortitude in that confidence today. But suffering and difficulty can shake our confidence. When you go through a difficult time, you go through a hard time, maybe you go through a sickness, you go through an illness, you have a family member who goes through a difficult time, it can really shake your confidence. And especially when that suffering comes because we're following Jesus Christ. When you're following Christ and suddenly you suffer because of that, in whatever form that may take, when you're following Him and suddenly something doesn't go like you expected it to, or you thought it was going to be easier than it is, you didn't know it was going to cost this much to follow Jesus, it can really shake your confidence. Some of those who came to Christ this past week while we were in Africa will be facing tremendous persecution. Some of them will suffer for their faith. And I pray for them. I pray for them. My heart bleeds for them because I know they're going to be confused. We talked with them about what was going to come, what we knew they were going to be facing, and that many had faced that same kind of persecution before them. But I just have this sense that even today, some of them are perhaps being shunned by family, maybe being shunned by their community. Some, maybe even physically, would be persecuted because they have chosen to follow Jesus Christ as their Savior. And it can shake your confidence when you feel like I'm doing the right thing. I'm doing what I ought to do. I'm doing what I know is right. And yet, I'm suffering because I'm doing the right thing. Jesus warned us that following Him would lead to difficulty. It would lead to suffering. He said about Himself, the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed. And on the third day be raised. Jesus knew He was going to face persecution. He knew that He was going to be crucified. And He said to all, right after He said that, He said to all, if anyone would come after Me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow Me. For whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for My sake will save it. God pulls you into His work, and God pulls you into His family. And as He pulls you into His work, and as He pulls you into His family, your life is then devoted to God's purposes and devoted to God's people. And as that happens, you will invariably suffer. The Apostle Paul wrote to young Timothy, those who follow Jesus will be persecuted. And if you and I belong to Jesus Christ and we love what He loves, we will commit ourselves to what He is committed to, right? We will love what He loves, we'll be committed to what He is committed to, and we will involve ourselves in the life of His people, and that will come at a cost. It will come at a cost. It may cost us money. It may cost us time. It may cost us energy. It will cost us the affections of our hearts as we give up the things that maybe we most would desire for our own selves. As we give up our own dreams to follow Jesus. I can remember when I was a teenager and a young adult, there was a song that was, I think, written by Lanny Wolfe. And I know Becky's familiar with this song. I've heard her play it. But it had just some profound words to me at that time. And the words were something like this. It said, whatever it takes to be closer to You, Lord, That's what I'll be willing to do. I'll trade sunshine for rain. I'll trade comfort for pain. Now listen to that. I'll trade comfort for pain. That's what I'll be willing to do. At one point, the song is so gripping to me. It says, take the dearest thing to me, if that's how it must be, to draw me closer to it. Take the dearest thing. I'll trade houses, I'll trade lands, I'll trade my dreams, I'll trade my plans, for I'm placing my life in your hands. And if you call me someday to a land far away, Lord, I'll go, and your will, I'll obey. That's a tremendous statement to make, and not an easy statement to make. That's one of those things I don't think you ought to take lightly when you pray a prayer like that, right? And that really is what that prayer, that song is all about. It's a prayer to God. If you and I belong to Jesus Christ, it will cost us something. It will cost us something. And in suffering and difficulty, even the most devout Christian can begin to wonder if God is letting them down. Is God letting me down? And because I'm suffering, am I being punished? And even the most devout Christian will wonder if it's worth it. Sometimes maybe you've paid a price in following Jesus and you thought it would be easier to just live a life where I indulge myself, where I do what I want to do, where I do things my own way, by my own agenda, and I do not consider Jesus Christ in all of this. You remember John the Baptist was in prison. He was wondering about what was happening and why he was going through all that he was going through. Jesus said of John, he was the greatest man ever born of woman. John the Baptist, the greatest man ever born of woman. But when John, who was in prison, we read, heard about the deeds of the Messiah, he sent his disciples to ask him, are you the one who is to come, or should we expect someone else? And what was he saying? He was simply saying, listen, if I'm going to suffer for all of this, please tell me that it's worth it. Please let me know. When the Messiah came, that he was going to set up his kingdom, and we were going to be free, and everything was going to, and everything was going to turn toward us, but it seems like everything is turned against us. Are you the one? Or should we look for somebody else? Sometimes when you go through difficulty as a Christian, you can wonder, you know, maybe there's a better way. Maybe there's somebody else out there I can appeal to. Maybe there's, but just like John, and just like John, we can be discouraged in times of suffering. But listen, suffering and persecution and difficulty might shake you. But if you hold on to Jesus in the midst of it, it will shape you. It will shape you into the likeness of Jesus Christ. Now what we're talking about here today really makes what we read from the Apostle Paul even more amazing. And I'm going to read, begin with verse 1. I got a chance to listen to Jimmy's sermon from last week. Great job, Jimmy. I'm going to back up just to put us in context and then move forward into verse 7 and following. But listen to these words. For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles, assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight of the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it had now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel I was made a minister, according to the gift of God's grace, which was given me by the working of his power. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to bring to light for everyone What is the plan, the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things? So that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was according to the eternal purpose that He has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in Him. So I ask you not to lose heart over what I am suffering for you, which is your glory. Being confident enough in Christ to deny yourself and follow Him comes from knowing a couple of things. First of all, it comes from knowing who He is, who Christ is. But it also comes from knowing who we are in Christ. And Paul's going to show us that here, to help us, give us an insight of that here in these verses. And I want to back up to verse 1, first of all. And I know Jimmy covered this last week, but I want to back up just to help us as we define this. And he says, "For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles." Now, humanly speaking, Paul would have to say, "I'm a prisoner of Rome," right? Humanly speaking, he would have to say, "I'm a prisoner of the emperor of Rome, Nero." Paul was writing from prison. The letter to Ephesus was one of what is called the prison letters. The Ephesian letter, the Philippian letter, the Colossian letter, and the Philemon letter were all what are called the prison letters. And Paul is writing, and he says, but he doesn't say, "I am a prisoner of Rome." Why not? Because Paul understood this about Jesus Christ. He understood that Jesus Christ is sovereign over all things. The word sovereign simply means reigns over all. It would be an easy way to remember that. Sovereign. He reigns over all things. You know, there are times in our lives when we feel like if stepping out in faith and making a faith decision puts us in a shaky place. And we start to feel like, you know, maybe there's not something there to hold me up. But Paul knew that Jesus Christ was there to uphold him and to help him, even though he was in prison. Even though he said, "I'm not a prisoner of Rome, not a prisoner of Rome at all. I'm a prisoner of Jesus Christ. I'm here because if Jesus wants me to be a prisoner, I'll be a prisoner. If He wants to set me free, there won't be a thing they can do to stop Him. My trust is in Jesus Christ. I'm not looking for Nero to set me free. I'm looking for Jesus Christ to set me free. If He does, I'll rejoice. If He doesn't, I will rejoice because my trust is in Jesus Christ." You know, when we begin to understand that He is over all things, it is an absence, one of the most comforting things, and yet one of the most unsettling things, all at the same time, right? When you put your faith in Jesus Christ, it can be unsettling because what do you give up if you put your faith in Jesus Christ? Control. Absolutely. You give up control. You don't really do anything for the Lord that you don't give up control. You're saying, "I am stepping out. I am willing to take this step, even though maybe I don't know exactly what's out there, but I'm going to take this step." And what are you doing? You're giving up control. You know, one of the things that happens when you go on some of these mission trips that we go on, whether it be one of our builders' mission trips to Alabama, or it be to Haiti, or to Jan Lance going to Guatemala this next week, whether it be to Africa or wherever it may be, one of the things you give up, right, David and Jay, you go to Kenya, and you give up control. I've got my life pretty well ordered. You might not know it by some of the piles I got laying around in places, but I at least know what's in the piles, okay? I have controlled piles. When I step outside of my own life and I put myself in the hands of some other people that I don't know, and I go on with an agenda, and what you find out is very quickly, all of that is out of your control. Everything is not nicely ordered like you'd like for it to be at home. Everything doesn't just work. And you know what? I think we all have to admit, it's really not all that ordered anyway, right? You know, and one of the greatest illusions that we have as human beings is that we are ever in control of anything. If we get that, I'm telling you, it is a huge step toward understanding who Jesus Christ is. Because when you understand, you think you've got all of life gathered up. You've got it all right here. And you've got a good firm grip on it, and it's all good. And what is that? That is an absolute illusion. You don't have any control over anything. You took a breath, but you don't have any control that you'll get the next one. Right? You don't have any control over anything. And at the point that we begin to understand that, then it's comforting to know that someone is in control. And it's not you, and it's not me, it's someone who sees the bigger picture. It's someone who holds the whole world in his hand. It's someone who is able to take the stars and fling them into place. And it's someone who is able to walk with you through life, day in and day out. It is frightening to give up control until you understand that you never had control anyway. And then you begin to understand how Paul could say, listen, I'm not a prisoner of Rome. Nero's not in control of my life. I'm not in control of my life. But Jesus Christ is in control of my life. Last week while we were traveling in Africa, we went to a large village by the name of Kita. And we bought some food there, and then we were going to make our way along a road that our IMB partner had been on in 2006. And he said, you know, it's not a good road, but I think it's good enough, and we can make it. And we're going to travel from Kita to Sandama. It's a shorter distance than but there, and there. We could have gone all the way back to the capital city and back up to Sodoma, but we thought this is a shorter distance. It's about 60 miles, 95 kilometers, something like that. And what happened though? We left Kita and we got on this road. And to call it a road is really generous. Okay, I mean some of y'all have been in Haiti on Ferret, the road to Ferret de Pin. That was a good road compared to this. I'm telling you, at places we lost the road, and when we got to the end, it took us about, Brandon, am I right, about 8 hours? Within about 8 hours to travel about 60 miles, and we could have easily gone all the way back to Bamako and back up to Sodom in probably 5 hours, something like that. And we thought, and our missionary partner with the IMB was kind of apologizing. We'd taken the long way and the hard way, and it really was a hard way. I'm telling you, our backs and our backsides were pretty weary by the time we got to the end of all this. But you know what? Along the way, what we found was on this road that was hardly a road at all, there were little villages that pocketed this road. And you know, God just kind of spoke to us as we were and realizing there very possibly have never been missionaries with the gospel that have gone to these little villages. And what we come to understand is right here is our ministry. We went the wrong way, but it was the right way because God is in control and we're not in control. And these are people who need to hear the gospel. And so, you know, it just impressed on me that we'll call it the road to Sodoma. All right, we need to go and take the gospel to some of these little villages along the way who very possibly may have never heard the good news of Jesus Christ. Our mistake was God's will. Isn't that amazing? And you know what? When you begin to put your life in God's hands in that way, and you begin to see the sovereignty of Jesus Christ, what you find is God will even take your mistakes many times. The things that seem to be upside down and all wrong, God will take those things and He will use them for His glory and for His good. And He will make Himself known even in the midst of all that because God, in Jesus Christ, is sovereign. And Paul understood that.
And so he's writing these people, listen, don't think of me as a victim here. I am not a victim. I belong to Jesus Christ, and he is in control. And this leads to the second truth, and that is that is found in verse 7. He says, of this gospel I was made a minister. And the word for minister here is really the word we would often translate servant. Servant. It is diakonos, which we use for deacon. And Paul is calling himself a servant. Now, if we were talking about maybe the greatest Christian who ever lived, who would we speak of? Probably the Apostle Paul. If you know anything about the Bible at all, you might say, well, my mama or somebody, well, I'm good with that. But I'm talking about, you know, as far as on the big picture, you'd have to say the Apostle Paul. But what did he say of himself? He says, I'm a servant. Over and over again, as you read his letters, he says, I'm a servant. And the highest regard he ever gave himself in this was he said, I'm a steward, which means he's still a servant, but he's over the master's things. But even at another point, he calls himself a galley slave. He uses the word that is the equivalent of galley slave. A galley slave was a slave that was down in the hold of the ship, rowing in this deep, dark hole. I mean, it was as low as you can go in servanthood. Okay? And at one point he calls himself a galley slave. And what I want you to understand is who we are. He is sovereign. We are servants. We are servants. Now I know that at a point that Jesus said, you are my friends, and we would consider ourselves friends of God. Another point in the New Testament says we are brothers. Christ is our brother. But I think in reference to who we are before God, we would have to say that we are called to ministry or to servanthood. And that means every one of us. That means every one of us. None of us are exempt. We are all called to servanthood. Of this gospel, I was made a minister, he said. Of this gospel, I was made a servant. And what we're going to see here is what that means for us. And I'm trying to do this very quickly. Hang with me as we look at what he says after this, on through verse 13. Jesus said at the point, if I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you also should do just as I have done to you. Truly, truly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. Folks, the reason I tell you this is because I believe the greatest blessing comes from, first of all, knowing who he is. He is sovereign. And knowing who we are. We are servants of God. Every one of us, servants of God. So Paul says, I was made a minister, or made a servant. And he's talking here, look at the language he uses. I was made this. I was made this. And what I want you to first of all understand is your service is a calling. It is a calling. It is a mandate, essentially. You know, I shared with you before that when I came to Christ, I remember as a boy, I can still remember very vividly as I said to you, I could not do it. There was a point at which I felt God calling me to himself so clearly, so in such a real way, that I could not do it. But as a young adult, when I was at a time in my life when I could measure all that and kind of understand what does it mean to follow Jesus, I felt God calling me to himself, to servanthood. And in the same way that I was called to salvation, and I could not do it, I was called to serve. I was called to minister. I could not do it. I mean, it was so clear. It was so real. I knew that something in my life would break if I didn't follow Jesus and serve. And I'm telling you, I hope you've come to that place in your life. I'm not saying it's the same for everybody. I'm not saying it looks the same. But I hope you have come to a point, a place in your life where you understand your life is not your own. You have been bought with a price. Jesus said, you can't come and follow me. Listen, don't miss this. You can't come and follow me unless you deny yourself and take up your cross and follow me. If anyone would come after me, he must. He must. It is not an option. It is not okay, I think I'll take door number 3. You know, no, there's one door, and that's Jesus Christ. And that's Jesus Christ. And the door to Jesus Christ comes from denying yourself, taking up your cross, and following Him. Folks, how does this fit with our ideal that being a Christian is a way to indulge ourselves, and being a part of the church is another way to make our lives easier, to make life a little more presentable, and make us, you know, how does that fit? I'm telling you, it doesn't fit. Following Jesus is going to cost you. And we have watered this down in so many ways, and we tried to say, well, God doesn't call everybody to the same thing. I'm going to tell you, at the foundation of His calling, yes, He does. Don't miss this. Because you cannot follow Jesus and keep your own life. You're going to have to give up your life. Do you understand that? And anything, if we don't see that, folks, we're playing a game. We're playing a game. We call it Christianity. We call it church. It's not what He intended at all. And it will not be rewarded when it comes to the end. So, Paul said, I've been called to this. But then he says this. He says, according to the gift of God's grace. And what he's saying is, your service is a gift. It's a gift from God. You don't have to serve God. Let me say it this way. You don't have to serve God. You get to serve God. You get to serve. Paul could never get over this, that he was such a, that the state his life was in before Jesus Christ met him on the road to Damascus. He realized, I'm a persecutor of Christians. I'm a terrible person. I'm a self-righteous person. I'm the ugliest kind of person you can imagine before God. Even though he would have been counted as moral and all those things in his community, Paul said, I was as ugly as it gets, but I'm going to tell you, He's called me to Himself, and that calling is a gift, and He never got over it. He never got, why would He call me to this? Why would He allow me to even be His galley slave? Why would He let me be who I am? You do not have to serve God. You get to serve Him. The highest privilege of your life is to live your life for Jesus Christ. That He would allow any of us to even get close to His throne without consuming us is an absolute wonder beyond wonders. And He has called us to this according to the gift of God's grace. And then He says, which was given me by the working of His power. And what I want you to see here is your service is empowered. Even though you are called to something difficult, and you are called to something hard, and you're called to deny yourself, you're not just thrown, cast to the wind, and do the best you can. He's going to empower you. He's going to give you strength to do what He's called you to do. And you will find His strength to be perfect, and you will find His strength to be more than adequate for everything that you could possibly need. Your service is empowered. And at one point, Paul writes to the church of Corinth, he says, there are varieties of service with the same Lord, and there are varieties of activities, but it's the same God who empowers them all in everyone. Listen, one gift is not empowered more than another. One servant is not empowered more than the same power that was given to Paul was given to you. And the same power that is given to me as a pastor is given to you. We have this hierarchy thing that is so wrong in the New Testament. We are all called together under the same Lord and under the same Spirit and thus under the same power. Your service is empowered. And he says in verse 8, to me, though I am the very least of all the saints, and I don't think this is false, kind of a false humility here. And Paul is saying, listen, I'm the least. At one point he says, I'm the chief of sinners. Another point he says, I'm the least of all the apostles. Here he says, I'm the least of all the saints. And what I want you to see here is that your service is humbling. For those of you who've been Christians for a while, you understand this. If you have truly been following the Lord, that even though you've been a Christian for a while and your sin is not greater necessarily than it was when you first became a believer. In fact, you may be walking in a strong, far more strongly than you were then. But the reason you have a greater sense of your sin and a greater sense of humility than you did at the beginning is because the closer you get to Christ, the more He shines and the more you realize how unworthy you are to be counted among Him or with Him. And Paul was absolutely amazed that he would be called. And he was absolutely amazed. He said, I'm the least. What? Who am I to be considered anything whatsoever? I'm the least. Because he got so close to Jesus, he'd come to understand the depth of his sin and the glory of Christ. And he says this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. And the point I think here is this, is your service will lead people to delight in Jesus Christ. Your service will lead people to delight in Jesus Christ. Now listen to me here, folks. Because many of you are serving the Lord. Your service is faithful. You're in this body, in this community, in so many ways. You are serving, and you are serving faithfully. You know what happens when people begin to see people like you, people like me, making sacrifices? Now, this doesn't happen to everyone who sees this. But there are those people who take stock of what is being done, and they are absolutely amazed that we would lay anything on the line to reach out to them in the way that we do. It is one of our greatest witnesses that we make sacrifices for others. And when they see us make those sacrifices, they look at us like, why would you lay so much on the line? Some of you have gone on our Builder's Mission trips, and if you've gone to the grocery store while you're there or something, they'll say, why are you here? Why would you come and give up a week of vacation? And why would you give up time? And why would you do this to come to this community where you don't know anybody and give them your time and serve in the way that you do? I remember a couple of years ago when we were in Haiti, we were sharing the gospel kind of door to door, and there was this young lady who was heard me as I shared the gospel message, and she said, I'm waiting for a sign before I come to Jesus. And I said, lady, I have left the United States of America, left my home, and come to Haiti. What more do you want us to do? That's your sign. And she smiled, a big smile, and she gave her life to Jesus Christ. Amen. You know what? When you make sacrifices, some people will miss it. Some people are never appreciated. When we make sacrifice in this community, some of you serve in difficult ministries, working with maybe hard-to-reach children, or you serve in a place where you feel like maybe there are people who don't appreciate what's being done. But I'm going to tell you, there is somebody who's watching, and there's somebody who's going to see the riches of Christ through your service. This past week while we were in Africa, over and over, even people who did not believe the message of the gospel, who were not willing to surrender to Jesus Christ, would say, you've come so far to share this message with us. They were absolutely amazed that anybody would do that. And I'm telling you, folks, it is not lost on the world around us when we make these sacrifices. And it certainly is not lost on heaven. It is certainly not lost on heaven. As we are faithful to gather with brothers and sisters in worship, we're preaching a sermon to a watching world. As we serve in this community, we're preaching a sermon to a watching world. As we love one another and minister to one another, we are preaching a sermon to a watching world. The riches of Christ is being made known. Your service will lead people to delight in Jesus. Verse 9, and to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church, and I want to stop there, your service is centered in the church. Your service is centered in the church.
So many, you know, so many people say that I can be a Christian and not be in the church. I'm going to tell you, the Apostle Paul knew nothing of that. The New Testament knows nothing of that. You can justify that all you want in your own mind, but the New Testament knows nothing of that. It was written to the church. If you miss that, you've missed such a fundamental truth. You are losing yourself in yourself, in your own self-centeredness. And you are not going to make an impact on this world. And you're going to die in your selfishness. You are called to the church. The service is centered in the church. And then he says, the manifold wisdom of God, that the manifold wisdom of God might be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. Your service is on display for His glory. I wish I had time. This is one verse that I could preach on for 3 or 4 weeks. But listen, Paul says that the New Testament people of God don't just show the world the brilliance of the gospel, but angels and demons see it too. Angels see it and they rejoice. Demons see it in anguish because they have rebelled against the very King of glory. And we are on display, and we are being watched even right now by angels, by demonic force, rulers and authorities, they are called here. And what we are seeing here, simply this, your service is on display for His glory, for even a world that we cannot see. Then he says, this was according to the eternal purpose that He has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord. Your service links you to the eternal plan of God. This is what God has been doing throughout the ages, and you are linked to that. Verse 12, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in Him. Your service will lead you to a growing confidence in God. The more you serve, the more confident you become as you see God doing His work through you. You will depend all the more on Him, and you will see Him do what only He can do through you, and your confidence will grow. Paul says, we have boldness and access with what? Confidence. Confidence through our faith in Him. And then he ends this passage, verse 13, so I ask you not to lose heart over what I am suffering for you, which is for your glory. He's saying, listen, don't let the suffering and the difficulty that you see me going through get you down. I've thought a lot about that this week. And I'll be honest with you, there was a part of me when we went to Africa. I've never gone to a place where there was 80% people who were of another religion. Many of whom are absolutely hostile to Christianity. I wonder, Beach Grove, what might have happened. What might happen to this church if in going something terrible had happened to those of us who went. Now, I don't even, it's hard for me to think about. But in some persecution, in some way, something had happened. What would happen to our mission endeavors? Would we continue to go? Would we continue, would we say, I'm not sure it's worth it? Would we get discouraged? Or would we be all the more resolved to go? I hope it would be the latter. I hope that we would say nothing is going to turn us back. I can tell you there were moments as we prepared to go that there was part of me that said, this is crazy. This is crazy. But something inside of me from the Lord is saying, you gotta go, you gotta go, you gotta go. And everything seemed at times turn against us going. But I can tell you there are about 20 young men in a little village that we went to who turned their lives to Jesus Christ today. And I take no personal credit for that except that we went and we were obedient to Jesus Christ.
Are we willing to pay the price? Are we willing to be a people who say, I understand exactly what Jesus was saying. He said very clearly, if you're going to come after me, you're going to have to deny yourself and take up your cross and follow me. Are we willing to pay the cost? At one point, the followers of Jesus, we are told, in Luke chapter 5, it says that when they had brought their boats to land, they'd heard Jesus, they'd heard his message, they left everything and they followed him. Now listen to that. Don't miss that. They left everything and they followed him. A little bit later on, they began to wonder about that and they began to take stock in that. You can imagine that you'd do that, right? And they have a, Jesus has a young man come to him, and he's called the rich young ruler. We call him the rich young ruler. And this guy was so qualified to be a follower of Jesus. I mean, he was really moral. He was rich. I mean, he's the guy you want to sit on the front row, right? He's got the means. He's got the morals. He's got all these things. He's got a prominent place in the community. Man, this guy would help the cause, right? Let's get him in. Whatever we have to do, whatever we have to compromise, let's get this guy in. The young man comes to Jesus, and Jesus tells him, ultimately challenges him to such a degree that the young man could not meet the challenge. He would not meet the challenge. And he turned and walked away from Jesus. And Jesus turns back to his followers, and he said, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. And the humor wasn't lost on his followers. And what he was saying wasn't lost on his followers. And one of them speaks up and says, that, Lord, who can follow you? Who can be saved? And Jesus said that man is it is impossible, but with God, nothing is impossible. And Peter, who was kind of, you know, always answering, you know, asking the questions everybody else was afraid to ask. Because I think everybody was probably wondering. Peter began to say to him, see, we have left everything and followed you. And Jesus said, truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or lands for my sake and for the gospel who will not receive 100-fold now in this time houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions and in the age to come eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first. You see, in God's economy, those who die live. Those who deny themselves are fulfilled. Those who give up receive. Those who are last are made first. That's who's called to be a servant of the Son, Jesus Christ.